The learning objectives of this chapter are that the learner will have a basic overview of the refinery process as the source of marine fuel oil, know the main components that make up marine fuel oils, know the structure of basic hydrocarbons, and know the other common elements that occur in the fuel structure. Petroleum crude oil, or crude oil as it is commonly known, forms over millions of years in underground porous rock structures. This is thought to be due to the decomposition of organic matter, such as animal and plant remains, under the influence of temperature and pressure. Crude oil is a mixture of a large number of hydrocarbon compounds, each having different molecular structures. It is these structures which dictate the physical and chemical properties of the compound. We will be looking at some of the hydrocarbon structures to see how these various combinations of hydrogen and carbon influence these properties. In its natural state, crude oil has very little practical use, but it has huge potential, since the individual compounds that it is made up from are the raw materials for producing fuels, plastics, and chemicals in the petrochemical industry. In order to separate the different compounds, or products as they are often referred to, the crude oil is subject to a series of processes, which together are commonly known as oil refining. The processes involved in oil refining use both physical and chemical means to achieve the required results. The various hydrocarbon compounds contained within crude oil have different boiling temperatures. This fact is used as the basis for separating the components of the crude oil through a process called fractional distillation. This is really just the first stage used in modern refining, and, as you will see later, additional, more complex processes are now employed in an effort to maximize product output. The boiling temperature is the temperature at which a liquid changes state into a vapor or gas. This is also the same as the condensing temperature at which gases and vapors return to the liquid state. In fractional distillation, the crude oil is first passed through a cleansing process to remove water, sand, and other impurities. It is then heated to a temperature of around 350 to 400 degrees Celsius. At this temperature, many of the components of the crude oil will boil, resulting in a mixture of liquid, vapor, and gas. The mixture is then passed into a fractionating column or tower, where the gases and vapors rise towards the top. The tower, which gets gradually cooler from bottom to top, is fitted with collecting trays positioned at suitable points. The collecting trays are provided with capped perforations, referred to as bubble caps. These direct the gas and vapor through the liquid in the collecting trays. As the components of the mixture reach the point in the tower where the temperature is just below the condensing temperature, they start to condense on the bubble caps, and the liquid product gathers in the collecting tray, from where it can be piped away for storage and further processing. Any of the crude components which did not boil, plus those components with the highest boiling points which condense as they enter the tower, gather as liquids in the bottom of the tower, as a residue of the process. Those components with the lowest boiling points continue up to the top of the tower and are taken off as gases. These gases are often referred to as refinery gases and include methane, ethane, butane, and propane, and some of this is used as fuel to heat the crude oil to continue the process. You will probably recognize some of these gases, as they are bottled under pressure and used as a fuel source for portable heating and cooking appliances. In between the two extremes, at the top and bottom of the fractionating tower, the other products condense at the relevant condensing temperatures and are collected. The main products are indicated in the sketch of a fractionating tower, and, as you can see, include some of the fuels that you will be familiar with. Atmospheric fractional distillation is limited to temperatures of 350 to 400 degrees Celsius due to the risk of the crude oil cracking prematurely at higher temperatures. Therefore, other processes have been developed to maximize the product yield from the original crude oil and to modify some of the product to meet market demands. Some of these processes use the residue from atmospheric distillation as the feedstock, while others use some of the lower-grade products as the feedstock. These processes may produce further product by either distillation or by altering the chemical structure of the more complex hydrocarbon components. The most common of these other processes are shown below. You can get a brief explanation of these processes by clicking on the buttons below. Vacuum distillation is used to extract further products from the residue of the atmospheric distillation process. It works on the principle that liquids will boil at lower temperatures when the pressure is reduced to less than atmospheric pressure. The residues are heated again under vacuum conditions, and vaporization of some of the hydrocarbons occurs. The vapor is fed to a vacuum distillation unit, where it condenses and is collected in a similar way to the products from the atmospheric distillation unit. Typical products are gas oil and lubricating oil feedstock. This process leaves a lower quality residue than the atmospheric distillation process. Cracking is the general term used to describe the process of breaking down the molecular structure of the more complex, heavier hydrocarbons into lighter, more useful forms. Thermal cracking is one such process that uses heat to break down the molecular structures of part of the residue and some of the heavier products from the distillation processes. Coking is a severe form of thermal cracking, which leaves a solid, hydrogen-depleted carbon residue, or coke. Visbreaking is a milder form of thermal cracking, where the residue from the distillation processes is heated to approximately 450 to 550 degrees Celsius and then mixed or quenched with gas oil before being flashed off in a distillation tower. This process produces various distillates, which can be further processed to meet market demands. Catalytic cracking is another process which breaks down the molecular structure of the heavier hydrocarbons, this time using chemical means as well as heat. This is achieved by heating the residues from the distillation processes at pressures slightly above atmospheric, in the presence of a catalyst. The catalyst is continually regenerated for further use. Aluminium and silicon-based catalysts are commonly used, and, as we shall see later in the module, are the source of an unwanted contaminant in some marine fuels. Hydrocracking is another form of catalytic cracking process, but with hydrogen being mixed to help form hydrocarbons from the carbon-rich residues from other processes. The study of organic chemistry covers any compound which contains carbon and includes those consisting of mainly hydrogen and carbon, the so-called hydrocarbons. To gain even a basic understanding of marine fuel and its properties, it is necessary to first consider some basic chemistry of hydrocarbons. In general, the molecular structure of the hydrocarbons will define both the chemical and physical properties of the fuel. This in turn will dictate the various quality aspects of the fuel. We will look at fuel quality in a later chapter. Marine fuels are usually a mixture of a number of compounds from one or more of three basic hydrocarbon groups. These three groups are the paraffins or alkanes, the naphthenes or cycloalkanes, and the aromatics or arenes. Although these are the three main hydrocarbon groups, compounds from other hydrocarbon groups may also be present, but we will not consider them here. The alkane series is a group of hydrocarbons sometimes referred to as the paraffins. Alkane molecules consist of hydrogen and carbon atoms joined together to form chains. This group has the general formula for molecular structure and content CnH2n+2, where C is carbon, H is hydrogen, and N is the number of carbon atoms in the molecule. Molecules with low N values are gases at atmospheric conditions. The simplest molecule of this group is the gas methane, CH4, where N equals 1. The next in the series with two carbon atoms is ethane, C2H6. Then, with three carbon atoms, propane, C3H8. And finally, with four carbon atoms, butane, C4H10. All of these are gases, but as N increases, the alkanes exist as liquids and, at higher N values, solid waxes at atmospheric pressures and temperatures. A molecule is made up of atoms which are bonded together. Hydrocarbon molecules are said to be saturated if all of the atoms are joined with single bonds. The alkanes are all saturated, since each carbon atom has only single bonds with other carbon atoms and the hydrogen atoms. The alkanes have a high proportion of hydrogen to the carbon content, and therefore have better ignition and combustion quality than other hydrocarbon molecules of similar carbon content. As the chains become longer, the molecules are heavier and have higher boiling points, which mean they will condense at different levels in the fractionating column. The longer chains can be broken down into smaller molecules during the various cracking processes which you are now familiar with. The naphthenes, like the alkanes, are also saturated compounds, but, as the alternate name, cycloalkane, suggests, the molecules have a ring structure, not a straight chain structure. This group has the general formula for molecular structure and content as shown, where C is carbon, H is hydrogen, and N is the number of carbon atoms in the molecule. As with long-chain alkanes, as the rings become bigger, the naphthenes are heavier and have higher boiling points, which mean they will also condense at lower levels of the fractionating column. As you will have hopefully realized, the products from the simple distillation processes are actually mixtures of compounds with similar boiling points, and will include compounds from different hydrocarbon groups. We can define aromatic hydrocarbons for our purpose as those compounds which have at least one benzene ring in the molecular structure. Unlike the other two groups of hydrocarbons that we have looked at, the aromatics are classed as unsaturated. In simple terms, this means that some of the atoms have either double or triple bonds. An example of this is shown in the diagram of the simple benzene ring. Other aromatic molecular structures can be multiple rings, sharing common carbon atoms or hydrocarbon branches or other elements attached to the molecular structure in place of a hydrogen atom. All of the aromatics have relatively high carbon-to-hydrogen ratios, with the heavier ones having high boiling points and poor ignition and combustion quality. We will look at ignition and combustion quality at a later stage. Asphaltenes are particularly complex hydrocarbon molecules, very heavy and often containing other elements such as sulfur, vanadium and nickel. The asphaltene content of fuel can dictate some of the performance characteristics, and it is therefore important to include it here. Asphaltenes in residual fuel oil can be the cause of stability problems, as we will see later. They can also badly affect the combustion performance of the fuel, and therefore increase the unburned fuel carried out with the exhaust gases. The refining process produces a wide range of fuels, which may be gases, liquids, and even solids. We are only interested in those liquid fuels which are used on board the ship, and these can be put into three groups: marine gas oils, marine diesel oils, and marine residual fuel oils. As you will now appreciate, each of these is a mixture of compounds, which are products of the refinery process. Marine gas oil usually consists of only distillate fuel, whereas marine diesel oil is mainly distillate but may contain a small amount of heavier or residual fuel. The compounds in each have similar boiling points and can be from any or all of the hydrocarbon groups that we have looked at. Marine gas oil and marine diesel oil are referred to as marine distillate fuels, and you will see later that they are grouped together for the purpose of standards and specification. Marine gas oil can be considered as a higher quality grade than marine diesel oil. Marine distillate fuel, or marine diesel, contains approximately 75% saturated hydrocarbons and 25% unsaturated hydrocarbons. The number of carbon atoms in each of the molecules would normally be between 10 and 20. Marine diesel is often a blend of gas oil and heavier distillate fuels from the refining process. There are four different grades of marine distillate fuels, as you will see in the next chapter. Generally, the only pretreatment needed before use in a diesel engine would be removal of any water or dirt. This may be minimal for high-grade diesel. Marine residual fuel, as the name suggests, is part of the residue from the oil refining process. It consists of a high proportion of long-chain and carbon-rich hydrocarbons in addition to other non-hydrocarbon elements. As the refining process has become more intense, the quality of the residue has deteriorated. To make the residue usable as a fuel, it is often necessary to improve it by mixing it with some distillate fuel. This may be heavy gas oil or similar. This process of improving the quality by mixing with a lighter fuel oil is referred to as blending or cutting. Residual fuel oil needs to be heated for storage and transfer. It also needs to be cleaned and pre-treated prior to use as fuel for a diesel engine. This can include preheating, filtration, and centrifuging. The non-hydrocarbon elements contained in marine fuel oils will depend largely on the original source of the crude oil and the actual refining processes that the crude oil passes through. The non-hydrocarbons may take the form of elements which are part of the molecular structure of the various compounds which make up the crude oil. They may be liquid or solid contaminants, either in the original crude or from the refining process. They can also result from transport, storage, or treatment processes. Some of the common non-hydrocarbon elements and contaminants that are found in marine fuels are listed below: sulfur, vanadium, sodium, aluminium and silicon, nickel, zinc, phosphorus, calcium, water, and ash. We will consider these non-hydrocarbons and the effect they have on the properties and quality of the fuel in a later chapter.